فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
So the first one, inshallah ta'ala, in which Hafiz ibn Hajar rahimahullah, it becomes clear to us after following his manhaj, his methodology. Number one is أنه رتب أحاديث الكتاب على الأبواب والمواضيع على طريقة المعهودة في ترتيب كتب الأحكام على أبواب الفقه. That the author rahimahullah, he organized the hadith of this book. He organized it and he placed it in chapterings that are well known in the jurisprudent rulings, fiqh. The way he organized it. For example, he started with Kitab al-Tahara. فَابْتَدَأَ بِكِتَابِ الطَّهَارَةِ وَثَنَّ بِكِتَابِ الصَّلَاةِ وَثَلَّثَ بِكِتَابِ الزَّكَاةِ وَهَكَذَا. He started with Kitab al-Tahara, and then he made Kitab al-Salah next, and then Kitab al-Zakat, and then he went on. And if you look at it, what he does after that is, ثُمَّ إِنَّهُ يُقَسِّمُ كُلَّ كِتَابٍ إِلَى الْأَبْوَابِ الَّتِي تَنْتَرِجُ تَحْتَهُ. And then after that, when he brings the Kitab al-Tahara, Kitab al-Salah, Kitab al-Zakat, what he does is, under every kitab, he brings abwab, bab. For example, if we look at Kitab al-Buyu', ذَكَرَ تَحْتَهُ عِدَّةَ أَبْوَابٍ. He mentions a lot of chapters under it. For example, he brings the first chapter of Kitab al-Buyu' is what? بَابُ شُرُوطُهُ وَمَا نُهِيَ عَنْهُ. The conditions of bay' and that which is prohibited in it. The first chaptering. And then وَبَابُ الْخِيَارِ and then بَابُ الرِّبَى بَابُ الصُّلْحِ and like that. So he writes Kitab al-Buyu' bab. All of those bab, تَنْدَرِجُ تَحْتَهُ. It comes right under the kitab. Are you with me? ثُمَّ يَذْكُرُ تَحْتَ كُلَّ بَابٍ. And then under every bab, he mentions what? الأحاديث المتعلقة به. That's connected to the bab. So now we're talking about the way he organized his book. He organized his book by following the well-known structure of the fuqaha when it came to writing their books. The fuqaha, they don't write their books with hadith. They only mention their kalam, right? But Ibn Hajar, he used the books, Kitab al-Salah, Kitab al-Tahara, Kitab al-Salah, Kitab al-Zakat, and etc. He copied them in it. And then what he did was, he placed bab under it. Bab. And he finds a hadith connected to the bab. This is the layout of the book. Point number two that we learn from the book and the methodology of Ibn Hajar is أنه لم يقتصر في جمع حديث على كتب معينة. Imam Ibn Hajar did not fully compile in his book a particular, he didn't rely fully particular on a particular book. For example, he didn't rely on only Sahihain, for instance. He didn't say, my book is only going to be the hadith of Bukhari and Muslim. مثلا. He didn't say that. Who did that? كما فعل صاحب العمدة. عبد الغني عبد الواحد المقدسي. What did he do? That's a shart he made. He did. Ibn Hajar didn't do that. أو شرط فيها شرطا معينا. And Ibn Hajar did not say, I'm going to follow this one particular condition. This is my condition. I'm going to tread on. He didn't say that. كما صنع صاحب التقريب الأسانيد. زين الدين ولي الدين العراقي. Yeah. What did he do? He has a book called تقريب الأسانيد, which is a كتاب حديث الأحكام. That's what he said. He said he's only going to rely on the hadith which I think, if I'm not wrong, his condition was what? I'm only going to rely on the hadith which are أصح الأسانيد. Are you with me? The أصح الأسانيد that were mentioned, the golden chains and the authentic chains that people scholars mention, yeah, he said he's going to bring it in that. If I'm not wrong, that's what I think he did, he conditioned. Imam Ibn Hajar didn't do that. So what do we realize from that? He did not say, I'm going to particularly narrate from a particular books of the Masadir. He didn't say, I'm going to fully rely on book Sahihain, like Sahib al-Umda, like Abdul Ghani, Abdul Bahid al-Maqdisi. And he also didn't say that which Sahib al-Taqrib al-Asanid said. He didn't say that. So, but what did he do? بل rather, إنه أراد أن يكون كتابه شاملا. Ibn Hajar wanted his book to be vast. not restricted. For what? أصول الأدلة الحديثية للأحكام الشرعية. He mentioned in the مقدمة, did he not say? أصول الأدلة الحديثية للأحكام الشرعية. To compile and to bring the fundamental hadith evidences that are in the jurisprudent rulings, which are in the legal Islamic rulings. All the authentic, all the fundamental hadith. Yeah. Huh? That are in legal Islamic rules, wherever they are, Ibn Hajar did not restrict himself. He mentions that unrestrictedly. In which the scholars of Fuqaha they rely on. So you see him relying on the Sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim, which he mentions. He uses Sunan al-Arba'ah. He also used Imam Malik in his Muwatta, Ahmad ibn Hanbal, al-Darqutni. He also relies on the three Ma'ajim, al-Tabarani, Ma'ajim al-Kubra, al-Wusta, al-Sughra. He uses all of them. He also goes to Bazaar, all of that, and other than that. If the hadith is weak, فَإِنْ كَانَ الْحَدِيثُ ضَعِيفًا. If the hadith is weak, فَإِنَّهُ يَذْكُرُ وَيُبَيِّنُ ضَعْفَهُ. He will clarify and say, this hadith is weak, this hadith is not recurrent, it's not, he'll mention it. وَلَوْ تَرَكَهُ كَانَ هَذَا نَقْصًا فِي الْكِتَابِ وَفَاتَ عَلَى دَارِسِ لِكِتَابِهِ بَحْثْ مَسْأَلَةٍ مِنْ مَسَائِلِ الْفِقْهِ الْمُهِمَّةِ هَذَا الْحَدِيثُ أَصْلٌ فِيهَا. And if he leaves it, that is a deficiency to his book. If you look at Ibn Hajar rahimahullah ta'ala and you follow up his kitab, if you look at the weak narrations that he brought in his Bulugh al-Maram, the hadith that he brought that were weak, it will become apparent to you, that the weak narrations that Ibn Hajar rahimahullah, that weak narration he brought has two benefits in it. The first one is, there is implementation on this hadith. The second one is, that the hadith that was mentioned here is actually Hassan for the chaptering that it's in. And inshallah ta'ala, many examples will come in that regard. We'll show examples when we come to it, bi'idhnillahi al-kareem, in the sharah of it. Number three. Ibn Hajar rahimahullah mentioned in his muqaddimah that he said, حَرَّرْتُهُ تَحْرِيرًا بَالِغًا لِيَصِيرَ مَنْ يَحْفَظُهُ مِنْ بَيْنِ أَقْرَانِهِ نَابِغًا. Ibn Hajar says, حَرَّرْتُ تَحْرِيرًا بَالِغًا means I have put excessive effort in. So the one who memorizes it, لِيَصِيرَ مَنْ يَحْفَظُهُ, so the one who memorizes my book will surpass his peers. And the effort and the hard work Ibn Hajar put in his book, these are the examples. This statement of his, حَرَّرْتُهُ تَحْرِيرًا بَالِغًا, I have put excessive effort in this hadith book. So the one who memorizes it can surpass his peers. The following things is what he has done. Number one, انتقاؤه للأحاديث من الأصول. He extracted أحاديث which are fundamental. And he doesn't mention Ibn Hajar except أحاديث which is صحيح or أحاديث which is حسن or أحاديث which is weak but there's implementation on it. or a hadith that a person cannot find for this chapter except this hadith. This is the only hadith out there for it. Number two, this is his hard work that he put in. Number two, after every hadith he mentions, who narrated this hadith from the A'immah, he mentions it. And not only did he do that, but he tried to summarize even the name of those who narrated it by saying, أخرجه السبعة أو الستة أو الخمسة أو الأربعة أو الثلاثة وهكذا. Summarizing it for you, saying the seven narrated it, the six narrated it, the five narrated it, the four narrated it, the three narrated it. And he mentioned what he means by those terminologies in the muqaddimah of his book, and we mentioned it right now. Number three is classifying and grading the ahadith. And not only grading it, but actually placing a ruling on it as well. If the hadith is outside Sahihain, if the hadith is outside Bukhari and Muslim, what does he do? By mentioning the hadith is outside Sahihain, Bukhari and Muslim, and he's grading and he's placing a ruling on it, he will tell you who authenticated it. He'll also tell you who classified this hadith to be Hassan. Or he will even tell you who weakened it from the A'immatu wa Hufad al-Ummah, the scholars of hadith, who from amongst them weakened it. Or he may even place a ruling on it from his own self, by classifying it to be sahih or da'if from his own self. Or if the hadith is defaulted, there's a default in the hadith. If there's a hadith, it's defect, sorry. If the hadith has a defect in it, he will give you the illah that is in it. Are you with me? But all of that he will say in a very well structured, in a very well structured wordings, very summarized, so even the person can memorize the grading hatta if he wants to. And this is why he had the upper hand over the Muharrar by Ibn Abdul Hadi. Number four, the other effort that he put towards it that indicates it is what? All of this falls under the point three, number three. All of this is under point three. Is اختصاره سياق متون الأحاديث الطويلة, the wording of the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ. He summarizes it. He doesn't bring you pages of narrations. He doesn't make a hadith which is, if it's lengthy, the hadith, he only takes from the hadith that which is accurate for the chapter that he put. So the student who's reading it can automatically see from it, موضع الشاهد منها, where is Ibn Hajar trying to extract the ruling from? And why is it, what was the reason he brought this hadith under this chapter? والذي لأجله أورد الحديث في الباب. Are you with me? And this is also something that helps the person to memorize this book. مما يساعد على الحفظ. And this is also what gave him the upper hand. وهو مما امتاز به على العمدة. And this is why he surpassed عمدة الحكام in the chapterings. So عمدة الحكام, some ahadith, you don't even know why he brought it in there. Number five is the majority of the times, after every hadith, he mentions the different sources in which he narrated it from and the wording difference of each source. He'll say to you, this is the riwayah of Fulan, and this is the lafz of this, and this is the lafz of that. He'll tell you which wording in which book it is. The majority of the times he does that. So this is another miza to give you the wording that you're memorizing. Where is this wording from? He'll tell you it. Very good. Number six. Ibn Hajar gave i'tina. He gave a lot of consideration. and concern by the ziyadat al-muhimma, the additional parts that are added to the hadith. On the matter of the hadith, if there's a ziyada on it, another riwayah brings a ziyada, he'll bring it. So if he brought a hadith, and then he knows there's another one out there but that has another ziyada on it, he mentions it. But also keeping in mind the takhrij of that ziyada. And if it's weak or authentic, he'll mention it to you. Because it could be shad, or if it's not, he will classify and grade it for you. Number seven. He brings the evidences. التي يحتج بها الفقهاء على المسألة مسائل. He brings you the evidences that the fuqaha use in a particular matter. He'll bring it for you sometimes. He brings you sometimes. And when he does that, what does he do? دون تعصب أو ميل لمذهب معين في المسألة فتجد أحيانا. He doesn't do that from any fanaticism in him to a particular madhab. He doesn't do that. Rather, sometimes, guess what you find? Sometimes, what do you find? فَتَجْدُ أَحْيَانًا sometimes يَسُوقُ فِي الْأَسْمَسْأَلَةِ الْوَحِدَةِ الْحَدِيثِ الْمُتَعَارِضَةِ. Sometimes, in a particular place, he brings two hadiths which seem like they are opposing one another. Why would he do that? The reason why he does that is الَّذِي يُمَثِّلُ كُلُّ حَدِيثٍ مِنْهَا مَذْهَبًا مُعَيَّنًا. Each hadith, a group of madhab held onto it. And we're going to bring examples, especially when we speak about Bayanul Hijamati Lissaimi. He brings the different two views that were out there. He brings both of the hadiths. So you can see them. Naam. Those are the points that fall under number three, which is when he said, حررت تحريرا بالغا ليسير من يحفظه من بين أقرانه نابغا وتحريره له تمثل فيما يلي. Number four, pertaining to the manhaj of the Mu'allif Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, number four. We finished point number three, we're now on number four. Okay. The fourth manhaj that we realize from this book after Tatabbu' al-Istiqra is أنه ذيّل كتابه هذا بكتاب الجامع. That Ibn Hajar, after finishing the Hadith al-Ahkam, at the ending, he brought a chapter called Kitab al-Jami'. And what does he mean by Jami'? He brought in the akhlaq, adab, dhikr, and etc. And this is a miza. This is an upper hand over the other books. He finished his book, so a person can liyakuna ruha lahu, so it can be a soul, a purification of his heart. وعلامة على علو منزلته, and that the person, it can be a sign for him to grow and nurture himself. And this is مما اختص به كتاب البلوغ. This is the unique thing that the بلوغ المرام gained عن غيره من المصنفات الحديثية في الأحكام, over the other books that are written in this particular field. We're now going to speak about the last point, inshallah ta'ala, which is the fourth point when it comes to pertaining to At-Ta'rifu bi-Kitabi Bulugh al-Maram. The fourth point, inshallah ta'ala. So again, one more time. The first one we were talking about was regarding what? The first thing that we spoke about is the intent behind Ahadith al-Ahkam and some of the books that were written in it. We finished that one, sah? We also spoke about the name of the book, attributing this book to the author, and when he writ it, and why he writ it. Number three was the methodology of the author Ibn Hajar in this particular book. We're now going to, inshallah ta'ala, go to the fourth point, which is في ذكر نسخه الخطية والمطبوعة. We're now, inshallah, going to speak about the manuscripts in which this book has, and those books that were published of it. في ذكر نسخه الخطية والمطبوعة. As we have previously mentioned, brothers, بلوغ المرام, this book, حصل من البقبولي, والمنزلة الرفيعة. This book gained a high position, admiration and love. The people, they hastened to take this book the minute, and this is rather even before publishing houses came, before this publishing machines and photocopy machines came, huh? This is way before زمن الطباعة. The people hastened. They hastened في حياة مؤلفه. When Ibn Hajar was alive, as we mentioned last lesson, huh, that some people were memorizing it on him and they were reading on him. وبعد وفاته, even after he died, people were also what? They were giving a lot of consideration to this. And as I said last time, قلا, it was little. And تجد مكتبة علمية, it was very little. To go to a library in which you wouldn't find this book. Very little. Or even if you went to a دار من دور الكتب العلمية العامرة or العامة, you'll always find this book present there. Whether it's universities, whether it's مراكز institutes, من مراكز البحث العلمي, except you would find عدة نسخ خطية محفوظة من كتاب بلوغ المرام. You find manuscripts present there. And when it became apparent, the time of the publishing houses started and books were being published, the publishing houses, they hastened to publishing this book, and it was one of the earliest books that were published. And they gave it وإعطائه الأولوية لإخراج ابن حيز المخطوطات. They took it out of the world of مخطوطات. مخطوطات means in the world of not being a handwritten book, by making it a printed book. So they brought it to the عالم المطبوعات. Why? ليسهل تداوله. So the people, it become easy for them to take from this book. And this book, it did happen. وتم الفائدة المرجوة منه. All of the good that was hoping came out from it. The people memorized it. Institutions and universities started to oblige people to memorize this book if they wanted to learn كتب الحديث. So we're going to, inshallah ta'ala, speak about the first places that it was published. The first, number one, the first place, طبع لأول مرة طبعة حجرية. The first time that was ever published, and it was in Lucknow. Huh? In India. And the year was 1253. The second time, it was ثم طبع طبعة حجرية أيضا. And it was, in this time, it was the second time was in Lahore. The year 1305. And then the third was the طبعة الأنصاري. And this time it was Delhi in India, the year 1311. And then the fourth is ثم طبع بمط, بط, it was then published in the مطبعة التمدن, which is in Egypt, الصناعية بمصر, the year 1320. And then after that, the fifth one was ثم طبع بطبعة مصطفى البابي الحلبي, which is in Egypt, in جماد الأولى, when the year was 1351. Number six was, it got published again by in Egypt, but this time with the تصحيح and the تعليق of الشيخ محمد حامد الفقي. الشيخ محمد حامد الفقي, when the year was 1352. The seventh is, it was then published, ثم طبع في مطبعة, the publishing house was عبد الحميد حنفي. The year was 1372. This time it had the تعليقات of الشيخ عبد الله ابن محمد الصديق الغماري. The eighth was ثُمَّ طُبِعَ بِدَارِ الْكُتُبِ الْعَرَبِيِّ. When the year was 1373 with the tasheeh of Al-Sheikh Muhammad Ridwan. The ninth is ثُمَّ طُبِعَ بِمَكْتَبَةِ النَّهْضَةِ الْحَدِيثَةِ فِي مَكَّةِ الْمُكَرَّمَةِ. When the year was 1378 بِاعْتِنَاءِ الشَّيْخَيْنِ. Two scholars that came together and they worked on it, Muhammad Amin Katabi and Abdul Wahab Abdul Latif. The tenth one was ثُمَّ طُبِعَ بِالْمَكْتَبِ الْإِسْلَامِي بِدِمَشْقَ. And this was the year 1393. And at the bottom, you would find the hashiya of Al-Allama Ahmad Hassan Al-Dahlawi. Al-Allama Ahmad Hassan Al-Dahlawi. Number 11 is ثُمَّ طُبِعَ بِدَارِ إِحْيَاءِ الْعُلُومِ بِبَيْرُوتِ with the tahqiq of Shaykh Usama Salahuddin Al-Manimana, I think was Al-Manimana. Al-Maymana. One of those two, if I'm not wrong. The year was 1413, in which they added to it the ta'liqat that were already on the previous copy of Muhammad Hamid Al-Fiqhi, and they also added extra things onto it. The 12th was ثُمَّ طُبِعَ فِي دَارِ الْحَدِيثِ فِي الْقَاهِرَةِ. When the year was 1414, with the tahqiq and the takhrij, and the fahrasa was put now, a content page was added to it, with a Shaykh Isamuddin Sayyid. Number 13 is ثُمَّ طُبِعَ بِدَارِ ابْنُ كَثِيرٍ فِي دَمَشْقَ. And then it got published in Dar ibn Kathir in Dimashqa. When the year was 1415, with the ta'liq and the tahqiq of Shaykh Yusuf ibn Ali al-Badiwi. Number 14, Dar al-Salam in Riyadh. They published it when the year was 1417. And at the bottom, you find the ta'liq, which is called Ittihafu al-Kiram. بتعليق على كتاب بلوغ المرام by لفضيلة الشيخ صفي الرحمن المبارك فوري, the author of رحيق المختوم, the seal of nectar. Number 15 is it was that وطبع بمكتبة النزار مصطفى الباز in مكة المكرمة. This time it had the تحقيق of the مركز الدراسات والبحوث في المكتبة نفسها. They did it themselves in Mecca. And that year was what? The year what? The year 1417. It's the same year in which Fadilat al-Sheikh Safir Rahman al-Bakafuri did. Number 16 is وَطُبِعَ بِمَكْتَبَةِ الدَّلِيلِ فِي الْجُبَيْلِ in Saudi Arabia, in Mamlaka al-Arabi al-Saudiya, when the year was 1417. This time, it had the tahqiq and the takhrij and the ta'liq, three of them. Tahqiq, takhrij, ta'liq of al-Sheikh Samir ibn Amin al-Zuhayri. And it was published in two volumes. And sometimes you'll find it in one volume, and it's the one over there. This is the one of Takhrij of Sheikh Samir ibn Amin al-Zuhayri fi Juz'ayni, right over there. And the next one is Maktabat al-Sami'i in Riyadh, the year 1418. They published it on the tahqiq of Nadhr ibn Muhammad al-Faryabi. And it published two volumes. Recently, Mahir Yasin Al-Fahl and Tariq Iwadullahi, I saw their two ones, they came out. Tariq Iwadullahi and Mahir Yasin Al-Fahl. If I'm not wrong, Halaq, Subh Al-Halaq, who done the tahqiq of the kitab, Nailul Awtar, by Imam al-Shawkani rahimahullah, and he works on Shawkani's works. I think, if I'm not wrong, he also has a tahqiq and a takhrij and a ta'liq on the kitab Bulugh al-Maram. So I never got the opportunity to compare between Mahir Yasin al-Fahl is one, Tariq Iwadullah is one, and Samir ibn Amin al-Zuhayr is one. But what I remember when we were studying this book, the best publication that everyone used to praise, and they would study it, and it was the best one, is a Shaykh Samir ibn Amin al-Zuhairi. If you could just give me that copy, inshallah ta'ala. A Dr. Samir ibn Amin al-Zuhairi's one, in which he done a tahqiq of it, and he brought the hadiths out, and he wa'allaqa alayha, even some masail, he talks about it. He said that this taba'a is a taba'a in which the manuscript that was relied on is ala nusqatin quri'at ala al-hafidhi wa alayha khattu, in a copy that was read Ibn Hajar. It was read on him. And also his writing are on it. And his handwriting is on it. If you go to page 33, he brings some of those examples in which he wrote his hand. He said, وَمِنَ الْإِنصَافِ أَنْ نُبَيْنَ أَنَّ الشَّيْخَ كَانَ مِنْ أَنْصَحِ النَّاسِ لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ وَيَكْفِي الدَّلَالَةُ عَلَى ذَلِكَ مَا كَتَبَ رَحِمَ اللَّهِ بِخَطِّ يَدِهِ فِي مُقَدَّمِ تِلْكَ النُّسْخَةِ وَهَذِهِ السُّورَةُ مَا كَتَبَهُ. And this is what he mentioned. He brings some of it. That's Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen's one, sorry. That's Sheikh Ibn Uthaymeen, sorry. Like, he brings some of the points where the author, rahimahullah, he brought. So he replies on the Nuskha al-Buqa'i. He relies on Nuskha al-Azhariya. MashaAllah, he relies on a lot of Nusakh. And every year he brings out, he looks into it and he brings out whatever he thinks that needs to be done. But that which I've known was this book was very good, this taba was very good, and Allah tabarak wa ta'ala knows best. We will stop there inshallah ta'ala in speaking about the ta'rif of Kitab Bulugh al-Maram, and inshallah ta'ala next set bi'idhnillah al-kareem we'll be speaking about Ba'd al-Ahkam al-Muhimma al-Mutaliqatu bi-Siyam. We'll be speaking about, which is going to be the third mabhath, we'll be speaking about some of the ahkam, the important ahkam that are connected to fasting. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik, ashhadu an la ilaha illallah, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayh.